I am very grateful to be here this morning, and as I told some friends in the little pre-ramble group that I got back from Chicago 12:30 last night and then came to Grand Haven in the morning, and I was expecting a smaller group and something intimate, but I think this is very intimate. But I'm grateful to Leslie and David for coordinating everything. And to be honest, I'm in love with your community now. I can tell you, I've been around the world and this place is amazing. I was so touched to see the children come up and sing for us, the wonderful musicians, and all of us who make it, as they sang, a peaceful day, a peaceful way, a peaceful heart, come what may, right? I'm going to remember that one. I'm going to carry it with me for a long, long time to come. And when they asked me what I want to speak about, I thought of meditative chanting, because that's something I've been practicing for more than 25 years now. I was introduced to it by my grandfather when I was 4. I never took it seriously. And then I realized that all of us do that no matter what. When we fall in love for the first time when we are teenagers, right? It may be just another Mary or just another Joe, but that Joe becomes special, right? It's Joe, right? You're repeating that name in your head and you absorb your being in that, right? Or say we are watching a football game and we are thinking that our team is just about to score, and says, go, 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 go. What we are doing is you're engaging in the process of meditative chanting. And across the world, across spiritual and religious traditions, people do this. If you went to ancient Israel and Moses was trying to gather his flock, and he said, Shema Israel Adonai Eloheinu Adonai Echad. Listen, O Israel. Adonai, the Lord God is one. Our Lord God is one, right? And in ancient Aramaic, the language that Jesus used to speak, they used to greet each other saying Maranatha, which meant, come, my Lord, or come, my beloved, into my life. And when Muhammad came in Saudi Arabia, he kept saying that I believe in the God of Abraham, Moses, and Jesus. Did you know that? That was one of his things, right? Pet peeves, as we call it today. And he said, La ilaha illallah, there is no God but God. But that was the recitation. And you move further down to Asia. The Upanishads from ancient India gave this mystical chant, Om. And they called it the mother of all sounds because it starts at the base of your throat, the first A. And the last one ends at the edge of your lips with an M, which is silence. Right? All speech, in a sense, ends in that silence, in that quiet. Right? And as civilizations grew in India, people chanted the name of Krishna and Ram, their names for the divine. And Mahatma Gandhi is said to have said Ram when he was shot thrice, right? And all his life he said, if I can part with my last breath uttering the name of Ram, I will know that my life has been successful. And every evening he used to sit and gather with his followers and sing. So what I realize is no matter where you go on earth, that practice of meditative chanting is there no matter what they chant, right? It is a part of mystical traditions from around the world. And the one thing I often tell my students is that religions practically differ on everything else except for two things. One, ethics. They all seem to agree on that one thing, you know. We shouldn't kill, we shouldn't steal, we shouldn't lie and cheat and stuff like that. The basic ethical things. And the other thing they seem to agree on are mystical experiences. Right? They seem to share their mystical experiences through similar metaphors. Whether you're looking at Jewish Kabbalah or Hindu Bhakti or Islamic Sufi traditions. And the other practice that kind of threads through these mystical practices is meditative chanting. And today, I want to speak briefly on a verse written by a 16th century Indian mystic called Chaitanya, who is considered the father of meditative chanting. And he used to do it in his home, and this was the time when parts of India was under stringent laws, and it wasn't allowed in public. And he came out and started singing and dancing in public because you couldn't be arrested if you were a madman. And that's how he broke the law. And in the 20th century, they looked at him and said, well, that was an early version of civil disobedience. But he's considered the father of meditative chanting. And he wrote a verse which talks about the seven powers of meditative chanting. It goes, Cheto darpana marjanam bhava mahada vagni nirvapamanam sreya kairava chandrika vitaranam vidyavadhu jivanam anandam budivardhanam pratipadam purnamrita swadanam sarvatmanasnaparam param vijayate sri krishna sankirtanam. That was a Sanskrit verse for you who needs translation. Cheto darpana marjanam, which means our heart is like a mirror. Right? And when we try to look at a mirror that is dirty, we are not able to see ourselves. The first thing that meditative chanting does is starts cleansing the mirror of the mind or the heart. And if you enter a house that has not been cleaned for like a long time, when you start cleaning, initially it looks dirtier than when you got in. But when you keep at it, it starts cleaning up. So that's the first thing. It cleanses the mirror of the heart so we are able to see ourselves. Cheto darpana marjanam bhava mahadavagni nirvapamanam. He says the world is like a wildfire. We don't know how we got into this trouble, what we did. But if you look at it carefully, sometimes when there is a wildfire, clouds appear from nowhere. The heat actually brings the clouds up, right? And it showers on the wildfires and it goes off. Meditative chanting is like the shower on a wildfire. It extinguishes the fire burning in our lives. Sreya kairava chandrika vitaranam. And it spreads its rays like a full moon. Right? Sometimes, from the place I'm in, I grew up in India, you get about 110 to 115 for a few months every year. And it's really hot. Really hot. But every evening we go out, and sometimes during a full moon night, we chill out. We're just sitting on the terrace and enjoying the full moon. The rays of the moon are considered to be soothing. And that's what it is like. Sometimes when we are in pain, we have to cut off the source of that pain, but we also have to let the place heal. And meditative chanting is like that healing ointment, that rays of the moon that heals our soul. Shreya Kairava Chandrika Vitaranam Vidyavadu Jeevanam. It is the life essence of all wisdom. If you are not able to sing and dance because of the weight of knowledge, says Chaitanya, what is the use of that knowledge? It is the life essence of all wisdom, right? To relish that meditative chanting and to sing and dance and celebrate. Vidyavadu Jeevanam. Anandam Budivardhanam. Said, and when that happens, you realize your heart is like a big white ocean. And just as the full moon comes up in the sky and the ocean, without increasing its water, actually swells up to reach out to the moon. That's what happens in your heart when you progress deeper and deeper into the art of meditative chanting. Right? The heart swells with bliss as it tries to reach out. Anandam Budivardhanam. And then Pratipadam Purnam Mrita Aswadanam. Is that every step you take, you experience Purna Amrita, pure immortality. You lose track of time. Right? That's what happens in deep meditation. Sarvatmasnapanam Param Vijayate Krishna Sankirtanam. This kirtan of Krishna in that culture, the most attractive one, or really, meditative chanting is something that we're looking for. We don't know where we're looking for, right? And the commentaries say, it's like we are trying to get milk at a bar. It doesn't work. You're trying to get happiness in things outside of us. It doesn't work. At some point, we need to sit down, right? And I'll tell you two stories and I'll finish there. The first story is a sad story about a particular kind of deer you find in the valleys of the Himalayas. Have you ever used musk? You know, the perfume? Do you know about the musk deer? Well, musk comes from a particular kind of a deer called the musk deer. It's a gland in that deer. Right. Now, musk deer, in that part of the world, apparently have a very sad life. This is why. As they hit puberty, as they become a little mature, they start getting a smell. And they are completely bewildered by it because it's such a great smell. It's musk, right? And so they keep smelling everything in the forest, thinking, where is the smell coming from? They smell the trees, they smell other animals, they smell the water, the earth, and they can't get this constant thing, just drives them nuts. Till one day they realize that it's actually coming from them. And when they figure that out, instead of searching around, you just sit down and enjoy the smell. And that's what the process of meditating is like. That we are looking for this validation, appreciation, happiness in everything we do, till we realize one day that the stuff that we're looking for is actually here. Right? Once we figure that out, we are able to sit down peacefully and relax and enjoy. Right? And once we have figured it out, no matter what technique, who teaches you what, it doesn't matter. It's like receiving a telephone call. You know, well, you pick the call and you receive the message. After you get the message and you understand what's going on, the rest is a piece of machine. Any techniques, any organization, anything are external to what we are feeling inside. Okay? And here's the second story. The story of an Indian prince. Who wants to listen to a story of an Indian prince? We should have a far side here. This little Indian prince got a blue sapphire from his father and pinned it to his turban. because that was his most prized possession. And one day, he went on a picnic with his friends in a beautiful forest. And after an hour journey, they started feeling tired. So the prince told his friends, "Let me quickly go and get a drink." And this is way back before the Industrial Revolution, so water streams were still clean. And he entered a lake which was still and beautiful, and he kind of went in and tried drinking water. And then he realized that that morning he forgot to pin the sapphire on his turban properly. And ploop, it fell. And you know what teenagers are like, "That's gonna kill me. This is the most important thing. He just said, if I take care of this, he'll give me other things." And it's like, "Oh my God, what's gonna happen now?" So he starts calling his friends, say, "Hey, I just dropped my thing. Can you please come in?" And his friends panic, right? And they all come in and they try looking, and they, you know, and there was a yogi sitting on the other side of the lake, and he saw the ruckus and came down and said, "What happened, my child?" And he said, "And in a state of panic, my dad's gonna kill me. I just, you know what it's like." And the yogi said, "You know, I can actually find you your diamond, but you have to listen to what I have to say." And he said, okay, what do you want me to do?" He said, "Come out with me." So he brought the prince out of the water. And he said, "I have one more request." "So what is it?" He said, "Ask all your friends to come out too. Because who's going to search for the sapphire?" He said, "I promised you I'll get it to you." So he brought all the friends out. And he said, "You can go and ask them to play, and you can come with me. We'll enjoy the forest." "But my sap..." I said, "Relax, come with me." He said, "Have you checked out these wildflowers? They're beautiful. They only come during the season." "But my sapphire..." "Well, I promised you I'll get it to you." And he said, "Have you ever seen a double rainbow?" And he takes him further and shows him a double rainbow. And the color in the rainbow reminds him of his... Right? And he says, "Now let us sit and meditate." "And but my..." He said, "Relax." And after a few hours, he brought him back to the lake. And by this time, because the people were not in there, all the mud had settled down. And right in the middle of that, he said, "Now, next time you walk, walk gently. Don't rake up more mud. And there is your sapphire." And sometimes we just have to be patient and let the mud settle before we get the sapphire, the peace, the contentment that we're looking for. Right? And the process of doing that is to have a calm mind. That's where we start. Right? And again, one of the techniques, not the technique, that mystics practice around the world that we are discussing today morning is meditative chanting. And I want to take the last, how many minutes have we left? About 5? I want to take the last 5 minutes of our time today to lead us together into a form of an interfaith meditative chanting where we sing Om and Maranatha together. Are we ready? I want us to sit straight. Back and neck in one straight line. And close our eyes. And take a deep breath in. And exhale slowly. Oh, Let us all sing together. A little louder this time. Let's imbibe the mood of Christ and saying, come my beloved into my life. Sing. Maranatha, 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 Maranatha. Let's sing together with all our heart. Peaceful day, peaceful way, peaceful heart, come what may. Let's sing it. Peaceful day, peaceful way, peaceful heart, come what may. Peaceful day, peaceful way, peaceful heart, come what may. Let's get our hands together. Peaceful day, peaceful way, peaceful heart, come what may. Peaceful day, peaceful way, peaceful heart, come what may. Louder, please. Peaceful day, peaceful way, peaceful heart, come what may. Peaceful day, peaceful way, peaceful heart, come what may. Peaceful day, peaceful way, peaceful heart, come what may. Peaceful day, peaceful way, peaceful heart, come what may. Peaceful day, peaceful way, peaceful heart, come what may. Peaceful day, peaceful way, forget it out. Peaceful heart, come what may. Peaceful day, peaceful way, peaceful heart, come what may. Thank you very much.